So let's talk a little bit about controlling the margin of error. So we worked through this example where we measured BMI within a sample of 16 observations. We found the sample mean to be 25.2, sample standard deviation of 5, and we built a 95% confidence interval that was two-sided. So this part here is what we call the margin of error. Okay, I'm going to abbreviate it ME. Okay, we saw in our particular example, the margin of error was 2.5. Okay. Now, this may be a bit too wide for our liking. So we might prefer to get a margin of error that's smaller, okay, or a confidence interval that's a bit narrower, okay, and more precise in its estimate of the population's mean. So first, let's talk a little bit about what controls this margin of error so we can think a bit about how we can try and reduce it. Okay, so let's talk about how we can decrease the margin of error. Okay. So you can notice that the margin of error depends on three things: the t value that we're using, the sample standard deviation, and the sample size. Okay, so let's think through all of these theoretically. So in order to decrease the margin of error, we can decrease the t-value that we're using. Right? Smaller t-value is going to mean a smaller margin of error. But what does that mean in reality? This is equivalent to decreasing our confidence. Okay? So rather than having 95% confidence, we can go down to, say, 60% confidence. That's going to make our interval narrower, but we're going to be only 60% confident that it contains a true value. And that's not really going to be useful if we have an interval that we're not very confident in. Okay. Mathematically, we can also think about decreasing the standard deviation. Okay. But this here is not possible. Okay. So if you think about it, here we're looking at people's BMIs, and there is some natural variability in that. Some people's BMIs are higher, some are lower. If you remember, the sample standard deviation, or standard deviation, is trying to capture on average, how far do individuals' BMI move from the mean. Okay, so there's no way for us to make people's BMI more similar. Okay, there's natural variability and we can't do anything about that. The final thing we can think about is the sample size. And we can see here, if we make the sample size larger, right, that's going to make this whole thing here smaller, or the margin of error smaller. Okay. So we can increase our sample size, and that's going to help us decrease the margin of error. Okay. And there's not much cost to doing this other than the time and money it takes to collect samples. Okay. So let's just work through an example. We're going to see how we can choose the margin of error that we want and determine what sample size is needed in order to get that margin of error. So let's suppose that we want a margin of error of roughly 0.5. Okay? Or in other words, we want our confidence interval to go from our estimate plus or minus 0.5. Okay? What sample size are we going to need to take in order to get that margin of error? Okay. So let's work our way there. We know that the margin of error is t times s over the square root of n. Now, we're just going to rearrange this a little bit. What I'm going to do is I'm going to bring t to the other side here, and I'm also going to bring the sample standard deviation to the other side. Then what I'm going to do is just flip both of these. T times s over the margin of error is equal to the square root of n. Okay. And then finally, I'm going to square both sides. And I'm just going to write them on the other side so it looks a bit neater or more organized. N is equal to t times s over the margin of error all squared. So now we have a formula here where we can sub in what's the level of confidence we want, what's the estimate of the standard deviation, what's the margin of error we want, and find out the sample size that's necessary. So in this example here, we said we'd like to have a margin of error of 0.5. I'm going to sub in the rough t-value of 2. Right, if we want 95% confidence, we're going to use a t-value or a z-value of approximately 2. And our sample standard deviation of 5. And if we work this out, it's going to come out to be 400. Okay, and again, as noted in earlier videos, I usually choose simple examples with simple numbers so we don't get distracted by calculations and we can focus on the concepts. Okay, so now we know if we want to have a confidence interval, okay, 95% confidence interval with a margin of error of approximately 0.5, we need to take about 400, a sample of size 400 in order to achieve that. So just some comments on this. The first is that it's good to make sure you plan ahead of time. So rather than collecting, say, 16 observations, finding out your interval is too wide to be useful, think ahead of time, what size of margin of error do you need or do you want? And then figure out which sample size is necessary. Okay, and again, as noted before, when we get to more complicated estimates, the formulas become a little bit more complicated, but the underlying concept always holds. A second note is that there's a push and pull between a real world and the ideal world. Okay, so in an ideal statistical world, we want to take 400 observations to get the margin of error that's desired. In a real world, collecting data takes time, it costs money. And there's always a balance between what would you ideally like to have and realistically, what can you get your hands on? A few other notes in this formula. What we end up doing is replacing the t-value with z. Okay, and again, this is mainly because here we're trying to work out a sample size, and the exact value of t depends on the sample size. Okay, so we can get stuck in this back and forth process. Also here, when we're doing a sample size calculation, we're generally looking at larger sample sizes, at which point the t distribution and the z are approximately the same. So it's not going to make a big difference. A second thing you may have noticed is here we are subbing in the standard deviation. Okay, now, if you're going to do this calculation ahead of time to decide what sample size do you need, you likely won't have the data to have estimated the standard deviation yet. Okay, so ways around this, ways we can get at that. The first is by looking at literature, okay, seeing if similar studies have been done or if there's anywhere in the literature that gives you a good estimate of what should the standard deviation of BMIs be. If you don't have that, you can do a small pilot study. So you can say collect 10, 15 observations, get an estimate of the standard deviation, maybe bump it up a little bit to be conservative and go from there. Or one final option is if you know that the variable you're measuring, in this case BMI, in the population is approximately normally distributed, you can make use of the fact that we know for a normal, about 99.7% of observations stay within 3 standard deviations of the mean. Okay, or in other words, the range is approximately 6 standard deviations. So if you can have some expert knowledge to know what's the rough minimum value and the rough maximum value, excluding the extreme outliers, okay, the extreme values, then you can get that range, divide it by 6 to get an estimate of the standard deviation. So these are some ways around that.
Thanks for watching our video. Stick around, guys, because we got lots more. Statistics is almost as beautiful as a unicorn.